walkouts. Teachers in south suburban districts of Park Forest and Chicago Heights have ended their disputes, but in nearby Thornton Township, high school teachers have turned down the school board's latest salary proposal. More than 9,000 students remain out of class there, another 1,500 students out in West Chicago as that strike winds up its fifth day. And by the end of the week, students in the Evergreen Park and Berkeley school districts may be out on vacation because teachers in both districts have authorized leaders to call a strike. Well, teachers who are on the job in some Chicago schools really had their hands full today, and they're blaming it on the Board of Education's new open campus policy. One principal in the Austin area described today's lunch hour as chaotic and said the board's new policy is resulting in a wholesale breakdown in discipline. There were reports of fights on the playgrounds, and a number of parents demonstrated, and boycotts sprung out throughout the city. Open campus means that the kids can either go home for lunch or eat at school and have then about 45 minutes to kill. Parents say the children who stay at school are poorly supervised. They claim that they roam from the school grounds and are, frankly, at the mercy of gangs. Now, this demonstration at the Otis school was apparently effective. The principal says that he will recommend to the board that his school return to the old closed campus policy.
Diane, children who are not quite ready for school, still a long way from there, are making this a good news week for two Chicago families. They've had reason to worry about the future, but as Jack Jones reports, the two new Chicagoans are making it a lot better.
These past couple of days, I've had the pleasure of reporting some happy news. News about people who ended months of hardship, who had a happy ending and a new beginning.
Yesterday, we told you about a miracle baby born to the Saraceno family, Peter Saraceno, who 4 years ago was pronounced dead at Westlake Hospital. Yesterday, Peter witnessed the birth of a healthy baby, his daughter, a baby born in the same hospital. Today, our story is about 21-year-old Elizabeth Sharpe, a young woman who suffers a congenital hearing problem, who last May was run down by a car while she was waiting on a corner for a bus. That car was driven by two young men who were suspected of committing a robbery that netted them $7. Last May, we visited Elizabeth in the hospital, where she underwent 5 hours of surgery to save her unborn child. At that time, she was fighting fear for herself and for her baby.
Is the baby going to be okay?
Yeah, so far, thank God.
It was yesterday that Elizabeth beat the odds. Fully recovered from her ordeal, she gave birth to a 5-pound, 10-ounce baby girl named Samantha.
And I was wishing that she'd be all right. And I was wishing 4 months, 5 months, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months, and finally she came out. And when I seen her and she cried, and I knew she'd be all right.
Just between us, did you want a boy or a girl?
I was hoping on a boy. Really hoping on a boy. But since my wife has been on, you know, through all this accident and stuff, I figured, well, maybe a girl would be best because to get their mother strong, you know, and real healthy.
I want to thank you, everybody, for being with me, praying for me and everything. And God bless you, doll. And I love you, doll.
Jack Jones, Channel 7, Eyewitness News.
Still ahead, a presidential visit to Chicago without the president.
And Mayor Byrne is packing her bags once again. Her destination, when we come back.
Does your TV receiver's performance leave a lot to be desired? Do you have to fumble with the controls to get a decent picture?
Then Magnavox receiver trade-in days are for you. Buy a Magnavox color television, and your dealer will give you a trade-in allowance on your old set and a free 1980 NFL record manual just for looking at Magnavox. So trade and save now.
It's Magnavox trade-in time at Village Magnavox. The Coal Miner's Daughter, Loretta Lynn in concert, North Lake Hotel, October 4th and 5th. Tickets at Ticketron, Sears and Ward's. For reservations, call 422-3535.
There was something special about the corner candy store. Old-fashioned candy store candy, made with fresh, natural ingredients. Even today, Brock's selects many natural ingredients like butter, milk, pure, real chocolate, sweet California raisins, plump Michigan cherries. The Brock's stripes tell you it's like old-fashioned candy store candy.
Double-dip peanuts.
By the bag or box, Brock's, the candy store candy.
President Carter continues to pick his campaign appearances very, very carefully today, sending First Lady Rosalind to Chicago. She was greeted by Mayor Byrne, their first meeting since last October. And Mrs. Byrne told a packed McCormick Place audience that if she had to choose at that moment, she would endorse the president for re-election. Then the mayor backed off and endorsed Senator Edward Kennedy just 11 days later. Also on hand at Midway Airport today, the mayor's daughter, Kathy, State Treasurer Jerome Cosentino, Alderman Roman Paczynski, and many other prominent Chicago Democrats. One Democrat who wasn't there, State Senator Richard M. Daly. President Carter is trying very hard to patch up his relationship with Chicago City Hall without making the Daly forces angry. And that's one reason that Mr. Carter has decided to start his Chicago campaign with a number of stops by Vice President Mondale, and today, a visit from Mrs. Carter. Our Larry Moore followed the First Lady as she made campaign stops this afternoon in Chicago's neighborhoods.
Mrs. Carter arrived here to speak at a picnic for retired members of the Clothiers Union.
Together, working together in the spirit of pride and patriotism and confidence in the future, together we can make this country even greater than it already is. Thank you very much.
As the First Lady left the picnic tent, I stopped her for a couple of quick questions. How are things looking in Chicago?
Fine.
Fine?
I just arrived and it's been wonderful.
Thank you.
Did you have a good meeting with the mayor?
I did. I met at the airport. Glad to see you. It's very nice meeting you.
Mayor Byrne was not with the First Lady as she appeared here, apparently feeling togetherness at the airport is sufficient for one day. From the picnic, Mrs. Carter went next door to the union's child care center, where she was serenaded by 3- and 4-year-olds.
Hello, and how are you? I'm fine, and I hope that you are too.
The First Lady took her shoes off, sat on the floor, and the youngsters presented her with flowers and their prized artwork. For Mrs. Carter, it was another campaign stop on a long, busy day. But for the youngsters here at the daycare center, it was a day they won't soon forget. Larry Moore, Channel 7, Eyewitness News.
From the daycare center, the First Lady went on to the Hyatt Regency Hotel here in Chicago, where she met with reporters. And that news conference is just over. Our Hugh Hill is there live to tell us what Mrs. Carter had to say. Hugh?
Well, Diane, if there were any doubts in your mind or mine, Mrs. Carter cleared it up very clearly tonight. There is a love affair, apparently, between Mayor Jane Byrne and the Carter administration. She stood here just a few moments ago and told us that she was very happy to have Mayor Byrne on board the campaign, and she hopes that Mayor Byrne will be used extensively in the Carter campaign from now until November. And as you said earlier, or perhaps you said earlier, Mayor Byrne's going to Washington tomorrow to meet with President Carter. So indeed, there is a love affair, and it's between the Carter people and Mayor Jane Byrne of Chicago, and Mrs. Carter also promised that there may be some more money coming in toward this city. Well, she was also asked about whether she thinks that President Carter should debate Ronald Reagan and John Anderson.
That it is very important to the country for Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan, who might possibly be the two choices, the two candidates, major candidates, to debate before the people. As I have said before, we have never had any assurances that that will ever happen. John Anderson has not won. He has, the people have spoken. He has never won a primary. He has never won a caucus state. And so I think the people have spoken in his case. He tried for all of them. He's not won till the people have spoken. There are two major candidates, and I think the people of the country have need to hear those two debate.
And she said that the president has made up his mind, whether it's going to hurt him or not, he will not debate Reagan Anderson together. Now, one more thing about Mayor Byrne. I said there's a love affair between her and the Carter administration, but apparently not between her and Richard M. Daly. Right here in this hotel, about 100 yards from here tonight, they're going to have a fundraiser for Daly. Mayor Byrne will not be here. She was not invited. This is Hugh Hill live at the Regency Hyatt.
Thank you very much, Hugh. As she said, that the mayor will not attend that fundraiser tonight, but First Lady Rosalind Carter will. Richard M. Daly is running against incumbent Bernard Carey in a close race for Cook County State's Attorney. Mayor Byrne has not been invited. We say she will have her share of the limelight tomorrow. However, as Hugh mentioned, the mayor has been invited and has accepted a White House invitation for a reception honoring a Chinese deputy premier. It seems, to coin or add to a new phrase, all is fair and nothing's unexpected in love, war, or politics. Mayor Byrne has already announced a gift from the Carter administration, federal money needed for massive improvements at O'Hare. It's already been approved, and so work will begin soon to alleviate congestion at the world's busiest airport, at least until a new international terminal is built in the mid-1980s. The project can actually be broken down into five phases, concentrated on expansion. Safety and security will also get underway once the takeover is complete. Better lighting and more equipment will help keep runways clear. The prime target of the project, however, is the existing international terminal, where the flow of passengers will be speeded up as more inspection booths are added, a new baggage system is installed, and the departure lounge is remodeled. Does all this sound too good to be true? There's more, according to Mayor Byrne, at a news conference this morning.
Like the discussions.
We're also speaking of freeing up the entire international terminal at the present time, once we build a new one, which will give us more domestic flights, and also the potential construction of an additional wing that Delta Airlines is involved in.
The mayor, backed by her new 15-member Airport Advisory Committee, was also asked about the threat of Atlantis taking over O'Hare's number one claim. Reply the mayor, no chance.
Also, some good news for Chicago's South Loop area. It's been chosen as the new home for Chicago's public library. And now there's an open call for developers for a building plan. Bob Petty reports.
This is the site of the city's new library on State Street, south of the Loop, where there are now adult bookstores. By 1984, there will be a different type of literature here. Already half the land needed to build is owned by Chicago. An estimated $4 to $5 million is needed to purchase the rest. Plans agreed upon by the library board called for a building for the library with room for a commercial complex of stores and possibly a number of condominiums.
All sorts of public transportation is available to the library user. And besides that, of course, we have all of the expressways that feed into Congress Street, so that there just isn't anybody in the whole city of Chicago who could not reach the Chicago Public Library.
For years, there have been two main libraries in Chicago. This building, the Cultural Center, houses a few books, but mostly records, films, and videotapes. The heart of the library is here in the 400 block of North Michigan Avenue, where an estimated 6 million books are stacked in what was once a warehouse.
On a busy Saturday, you'll find people standing or sitting on tops of low shelves or even on the floor in busy sections like the business information area.
Now the problem is how to pay for a new library. Earlier this year, Governor Jim Thompson vetoed legislation giving Chicago $4 million in library seed money. Chicago area lawmakers will probably try that route again. Another option, issuing bonds to raise the needed money. But library board officials say their next move is to find a developer, someone who can and who will build Chicago's new library. They say that hopefully within the next 3, possibly 4 months, they will have solid, definite plans on the drawing board. Bob Petty, Channel 7 Eyewitness News at the Library Cultural Center.
Speaking about libraries, coming up, Chapter 2 on the man accused as the plumber rapist.
And Roberta Baskin on the other side of Chicago Fest.
Just coffee? I saved your favorite donuts.
We had fresh Hostess donuts home, Rosie.
We missed you at the coffee shop.
Mom had Hostess donuts for breakfast.
Funny how folks who used to go out for breakfast eat home when breakfast means fresh Hostess donuts. Light, moist, and what a choice at the Hostess Breakfast Bake Shop.
What a choice. Too bad it's hurting Rosie's business.
Keep them home for breakfast with Hostess donuts.
There's one snack that's fresh and sweet and juicy. A snack that comes in its own little bite-sized containers. It's a cool, refreshing snack on a hot summer day. Always nice and light. You can eat a few and save a few. Or eat some and share some. Grapes. The natural snack.
There were a lot of places to go for Bob's college loan, but we went to Person to Person. What a difference. A lot of places could have given us a loan for our new garage, but we went to person. What a difference.
All over America, people are discovering person to person, the different kind of financial center.
As soon as you walk into person to person, you can feel the difference. The people here are trained professionals, and that means they'll understand you and your needs. You even get your own professionally trained account executive.
I think these payments will fit right into your budget.
Oh, great.
And you get unexpected extras like money management seminars and the free use of our financial library. That's all part of Person to Person Financial Center, which is a part of Citicorp, one of the world's largest, most dependable financial institutions. Professionalism and understanding. That's the difference at Person to Person.
Person to Person.
We'll work hand in hand with you.
The jury has been selected, and the first day in the trial of the so-called plumber rapist is now over. Highlighting today's activities, testimony by a 22-year-old Northside woman who pointed to defendant Brad Lieberman and identified him as the man who raped her in her apartment last December. She said she allowed him to enter the apartment after he led her to believe that he was a policeman and a part-time plumber, and he then began to search the apartment for leaks. According to the assistant state's attorney, the same ploy was used to gain entry into the apartments of at least two other rape victims. Meanwhile, Lieberman's attorney contends that the witness's testimony is not credible.
One case which never got to court was discovered by our Roberta Baskin. When a group of Chinese young people wrote Seven on Your Side, it seems they worked very hard for a Chicago Fest employer, but they never got paid for it. Roberta?
Jay, Mike Chan of the Chinese American Service League helped arrange the jobs for the 17 Chinese girls. They were supposed to work at the booth of the Gourmet Dragon restaurant for the 2 weeks of Chicago Fest. But after only one day, the girls were told not to come back. When they didn't get paid, the Chinese American Service League asked us to look into it.
Chicago Fest is the city's big summer celebration, and a big part of that celebration is the food booths, especially those from the ethnic restaurants in Chicago. The Chinese girls from Chinatown were supposed to attract customers to the booth set up by the Gourmet Dragon restaurant. But Chinese pizza, the featured attraction, didn't sell very well. So these girls from Taiwan, Vietnam, and China were out of work after only one day. They had been asked to buy black pants to dress Oriental, and now they were out that money and the pay they were promised.
I don't want to be quiet about this thing. Whether I get the money or not, I want all the people know these things.
Mike Chan says the restaurant operator who hired the girls is an American who calls himself Victor Dragon. Dragon has ignored any phone calls from the group.
Myself, I call more than 10 times. Anytime during the day and night, even at 11:30 sometime at night. It's unfair because there's nothing written. Okay, nothing is written. And it's fortunate enough that I took down all those information. I kept my own record. So otherwise, these kids would just absolutely no way to prove themselves they were working.
Since we were also unable to reach Victor Dragon, we enlisted the help of the Illinois Department of Labor. We gave officials a list of the names of the girls and the hours they worked. The head of the law enforcement division, Billy Pilling, said they would investigate.
Most of these people are people who have no other protection other than the Labor Law Enforcement Division of the Illinois Department of Labor. Many of them are not members of organized labor. Many of them have marginal skills. We're a little bit proud of our track record. In the fiscal year just ending, we returned over $1 million to the workers in the state of Illinois.
In the hopes of getting about $360 owed to the young girls, we met an investigator for the State Department of Labor at the Gourmet Dragon restaurant. But Victor Dragon wasn't there, and the workers weren't very helpful.
And I have to talk to the owner or manager.
Nobody's here yet.
Okay, what's his phone number? Maybe we can call him.
I don't know it. Nobody knows it.
After our visit, Victor Dragon called us from Kankakee from a payphone, and he told us he would pay the girls, and then late this afternoon, he gave Mike Chan $500 in cash. He said that should cover the wages and the cost to the girls for the black pants. Now, if you have any problems like this and getting paid, you should contact the State Labor Department, and their number is 793-2804. Again, call that number during business hours. It's 793-2804. Jay and Diane.
Thank you, Roberta.
And coming up, we'll have a look at some other people and their money in the news. Also, a look at the man who created Dick Tracy.
Introducing new Ham Special Light. Special because it's great tasting, and light because it's less filling. Try new Ham Special Light.
Greasy dirt can be a problem on your range hood, floors, walls, all over your kitchen. How do you clean it?
Ammonia.
Ammonia.
What if I told you top job in water cleans greasy dirt straight ammonia can't?
I disagree, because I'm so satisfied with what ammonia can do.
You'd have to show me.
Ammonia's good for some jobs, but not greasy dirt. Top Job has ammonia plus an exclusive combination of grease cutters.
Top Job did it.
It did it.
Took it off better than ammonia.
That's incredible. I'm really impressed.
You're both shocked.
You better believe it. This is still quite greasy.
Oh, this is
sticky, just gooky.
Feel the other one.
And it's clean as a whistle. If it cleans this kind of grease, it would have to clean a floor. I mean, that's the proof right there.
Top Job is definitely the product I'm going to use for greasy dirt.
Why? Right.
Because Top Job did the work and I didn't have to. It cleans the greasy dirt, and the greasy dirt's the worst thing.
Let Top Job cut clean through greasy dirt around your kitchen.
Cindy, since you're unhappy with your comfort shoes, try mushrooms. They're the real thing.
Okay, now walk.
Oh, I've never worn shoes this comfortable.
That's because of the tiny air bubbles in the sole.
And so much fashion.
You're right. I had no idea they had so many new fashion looks.
I'll take these.
I'll take these.
Look for the mushroom on the sole to be sure they're the real thing. Mushroom shoes are available at Marshall Fields.
No question, our town will be a political thoroughfare in the months to come, but there's a hot local race as well. State Senator Richard Daly is challenging incumbent state's attorney Bernard Carey, and it's bound to be close. Right now, Jack Jones is at a Carey fundraiser, and he joins us right now with a live report. Jack, are you there?
I'll tell you, Diane, there's quite a party going on here at Serene's. The scene of a lot of parties, but this one is for $50 a pop, and there has to be about 900 people in here, right, Mr. Carey? Mr. Carey, your campaign stuff says that you are not a politician, that you are professional. Well, we know that you're a professional, but what's this political talk about your opponent?
No, it's not political talk. They're very important issues in this campaign, and certainly the integrity of the candidates that are running is quite important. A couple of weeks ago, my opponent issued 1 year's tax returns and called that disclosure and challenged me, and I immediately released all 8 years that I've been state's attorney, complete listing of my net worth, and I've called upon him to do the likewise, to do the same. Not only that, I think it's very important that he disclose to the people of Cook County the names of his clients who have supplied this tremendous $130,000 a year income for a part-time law practice. That's amazing. How many lawyers 10 years out of law school are making $130,000 a year on the side? Because he should tell, because it's very important for them to be able to decide whether or not they've had any influence on him as a state legislator and whether or not they would have any influence on him as state's attorney.
Well, Mr. Carey, your opponent obviously has some kind of clout. The First Lady's campaigning for him tonight.
Well, he's been ducking a lot of ladies. I guess he's with one lady and ducking another lady tonight.
Thank you, State's Attorney Carey. Get back to your $50 drink. Have you had very many drinks, or can't you afford to have them at $50 a shot?
I haven't had time. No, we want to net out a little bit, so I can't afford a drink.
At State's Attorney Carey's party, I'm Jack Jones. Back to you in the studio, Jay and Diane.
Thank you, Jack.
Another politician still raising money, although no longer running for office, is former Alabama Governor George Wallace. He's just signed a contract with an independent production company to begin filming a TV special about his life. Abby Hoffman's looking for some money, too. A judge in New York wants him to pay $10,000 now, $15,000 more next week, or else await his trial on cocaine charges in jail. The judge ruling Hoffman has the money from book contracts he signed while a fugitive from justice. James McLaughlin, the man who tried to scale Sears Tower last month, has been billed $736 for his efforts fixing windows and window washer tracks, as the explanation Sears gives the man, who authorities coaxed inside well short of the top, leaving the Mount Everest of office buildings still unconquered.
But I bet just because it's there, that will happen sometime in the future. Each Tuesday night, though, we take a step back in time by looking in on the people who were making news in the past. One of those people was Chester Gould, but you probably know a friend of his much better. That friend, Dick Tracy. Frank Matthey has the story.
It was in 1969 when I visited with Chester Gould for the first time, 11 years ago. At that time, Chester was 69 years old, and he had already been writing and drawing the Dick Tracy comic strip for 38 years. He was an incredibly hard worker, 12 to 14 hours a day, 7 days a week. I found him to be an interesting man with interesting things to say, not only about Dick Tracy, but also about himself.
Chester, do you consider yourself a good artist?